Welcome, Playing for Change, the Transformative Power of Gaming. What I would like to do, I have approximately 35-40 minutes and then there's time for Q&A. I would like to give a short introduction of me, myself, and the research we are doing. I'm from Media and Culture Studies, so that's the specific perspective on game studies. What does it mean when we speak or refer to the transformative power of gaming? Does it exist and what do we mean with it? So I think we need a kind of a theory or methodological framework to understand what we're doing. And I would like to suggest or propose a discourse analysis to do so. And I will come up with an example to be more specific about the stuff I refer to. I especially like the Q&A because I have a lot of questions, so I hope you have all the answers. Like, I'm a trained philosopher and I've learned that asking the right questions is sometimes more important than to come up with the answers. So that is something I look forward to. A very short introduction. What is it that we did at Utrecht University? In 2003, we organized the first DIGRA conference. You all know maybe DIGRA, the Digital Game and Research Association. In 2003, the first one, Level Up. In 2005, together with a colleague, I edited the Handbook of Computer Game Studies. I see some people writing stuff down, but I can send you the PowerPoint if you are interested. And that was a kind of a strange period in time. It's hardly to imagine nowadays, but I was looking in 2001, I was at Boston, big conference on gaming, and I was looking for books on computer games. And they were really surprised, and he said, we have one book, From Barbie to Mortal Kombat, the famous Henry Jenkins book. Unfortunately for the French-speaking people, I think the best first book on computer games was in the French language. L'univers des jeux vidéo, the universe of video games, but it was not translated, so nobody knows about it. So this was actually one of the first overviews, and now it's hardly impossible to read all the stuff that's been written on games. So that's only 8-9 years ago, so it's I think still incredible how the field has exploded. We started the center. We are part of the creative industries in the Netherlands. There's a lot of money going to game research at this very moment in time. And Click&L Games is the game part of the Dutch creative industries research. The research we are in, we did some stuff on playful identities and a playful citizen, but at this very moment in time, we just started the Persuasive Gaming project. Persuasive Gaming from theory-based design to validation and back, this one. We have two PhD students and a postdoc. I will tell you something more about it. Basically, what we do is health games. Maybe you know health games are really important nowadays. The Games for Health conference is organized by a partner in the Netherlands. Come here in October in Utrecht University again. We have a graduate program with computer science. We have become a focus area at Utrecht University because at Dutch universities, people have to focus on specific kinds of research. We focus on game research, so there's a big interest in gaming research. And we have a summer school, I must not forget. If people are interested in game research and doing their PhD, please let me know. We're organizing a 2-week summer school in August this year, so please let me know. And I'm especially glad to be part of these two, both funded by the Arts and Humanities Research Council. This is the Patrick Rogan, the Bristol. And this one is, of course, here the Scots we are witnessing here today. And why do I like that? Because our stuff on persuasive gaming, I would like to make alliances with people interested in social change and games for change and politics. So I think these two networks are really promising, and I really look forward to setting up a collaboration the coming years. I refer to the ludification of culture in one of my articles in 2006, and it's always a bit of a tricky concept. You can, for example, claim that you can have the ontological claim that reality is becoming more playful. That's what some people claim, and it's a bit difficult to prove that is really the case, but I think play is becoming more and more important. For today, I would say it's more of a kind of an epistemological claim. Why do we use play in games? Why is it interesting for me when we have a look at social change? My question is, can we use concepts from game and play studies to understand the notion of social change? So it's a specific, like you put glasses on, if you put red glasses on, you see the world differently. If you use concepts of game and play studies, can we have a specific look at reality and can we understand better what social change is about? And then it's not the claim that the reality is becoming more playful, but that we can use the concepts of play and from play and game studies to understand what is going on. For example, the notion of playability. There are people who say we have to game the system, we have to play the system. And I always wonder, what do people mean when they say that? You can play according to the rules, you can cheat, you can be a spoil sport, you can be an outlaw or a revolutionary, where you create your new communities. And it's interesting that already Johan Huizenga in his 38 book, The Homo Ludens, already referred to those four possibilities of doing something with play. So in what sense can we use the notions of play and games to understand what is going on? And one of the questions I would like to have an answer on is the following. Kijk, I'm really interested in the work of Gilles Deleuze. This is an interesting interview. It was published in History of the Present. It's an interesting notion. And according to Deleuze, he said, well, what I want to do is trace and where necessary, create lines of flight, allow for leaks in the system. A kind of an anarchistic way of thinking about social change. So it's not so much about changing the system as such, but trying to find your own way through the system and allow for lines of light, as he called it. And he said, well, Michel Foucault, he was an architect. Michel Foucault wanted to understand how systems work, how we can change the system. And Deleuze said, I always thought of the work of Hakim Bey, maybe you know the book, The Temporary Autonomous Zones. How can we create some autonomy within the system to do the stuff we're interested in? So that would be a nice question for all of us to answer. Are we more a Deleuzian or are we inspired by Foucault? Do we want to change the system or do we want to create possibilities for our own sake to allow for leaks in the system? And that's a concept I must say I really like. Okay, to be more specific about this, I'm from game studies and I'm from media and culture studies. And to understand what it is that we are doing, I thought this book was always inspiring, the ludoliteracy book of Zagal. What does it mean to be ludoliterate? When we want to become ludoliterate, I would say we got to have the ability to play and make games, as Scott already referred to it. I think it's really crucial that we play the games we are studying. And I'm not a game designer, but I'm really interested in people making games. What I do as an academic, as a researcher, I'm more focused on understanding games. And what are games about? Now, what do I mean with understanding games? There's a multidisciplinary approach of game studies. People do social science stuff. What are the effects of games? Okay, there were some claims already here in the introduction that games can be useful for social change. And I always ask myself the question, how do you know? And can you prove it to me that it's actually the case or not? So there has been, strangely enough, not so much research done on the effects of game. In what sense do games help make and cause social change? And how do we know that? And what do we understand when we have these kinds of claims? I have more a humanities approach. I'm interested in the understanding of meaning of games. How do games construct meaning? How does it work? How can we understand how that process works? And of course, there's also a design approach. How can we design such a game? If we are a game designer and we are interested in social change, how do we design games for change that have the effects we're interested in? And I think, and that's sometimes a bit disappointing when you read all the stuff on gaming and social change, I think we should have a kind of a two-way approach. One is to understand the structure and components of games. We got to have a mean of describing the forms and structures of games, a kind of a meta-language. How can we make a good description of games to understand what games for change are about? And because we are in the context of human culture, we got to have a broader cultural discourse. We need to understand what change is about, otherwise we are too limited when we focus on games only. For example, I'm really interested in the lecture, for example, Matthias is giving. He's referring to the work of Bataille, to Adorno, to Benjamin. And I try, I don't know what he's going to say, but I think he will try to present to us kind of a broader cultural discourse we need to have in order to understand what Games for Change are really about. And when I have a look at all the existing literature on Games for Change, some people focus really on games and the games, the specificity of games. Other people have really broad cultural claims on social change. And I think it's our responsibility to bring those two discourses together to really understand what we are doing here in the coming year within this network or framework. And I will give an example to make it later on to make it more clear one possibility or how we could do that. So if we talk about games for change, we need a conceptual framework to understand what games are about, how can we use games for social change, and what do we mean when we talk about social change. I think there are different levels, of course. If people understand by playing a game better their social situation, then it's already something. If you want to transform this society, this capitalist society, into something else, and then we need another theoretical framework. So I think it's really important to make a difference between certain levels of social change. In one of the projects I'm in, at a persuasive gaming project, this is what we try to do. And we have people working on understanding the effects of games. So we are really testing at this very moment all kinds of games for change. Do they really have the outcomes people think they have? We want to understand how the construction of persuasiveness works, and we want to have a design approach. So we have three different universities involved from design perspective, from effect research, and what we do is more humanities research. So we study the persuasiveness, we try to figure out, and we could do that also with social change, what is social change? How do we design games for change, and how do we know, how can we validate those games that they really have the effects we claim them to have? And then there's a kind of a feedback loop. If the game turns out to be not working well or not as good as we expected, we change our theoretical framework and we change the design of a game to do a better job. And this is, I think, really important because there are so many games designed and we don't know what their effects are. For example, what do I mean with understanding persuasiveness? There's an interesting discussion, maybe you all know about this, then I do apologize. There was the famous work of course, Ein Bogist, who talks about procedural rhetoric. Basically, I'm not doing too much justice maybe to Ein Bogist here, but basically what he says, there's a designer, and you can design the meaning of a game into a game. And when we play the game, we only have to extract the meaning out of it. That's a kind of a formalistic approach of persuasiveness. Miguel Sicar wrote that really interesting article against procedurality. He said, well, Ian, it's interesting what you write, but you have to take into account the player and the context of the playing situation. You cannot just say that the meaning of a game resides in the game itself. And Mark G. Nelson, he came with a really interesting answer, and he said, maybe we have to focus on performance art. And we closely collaborate with people from performance studies in Utrecht. Performance art with an agenda. Players are forced out of their expectations, setting up situations with meaning not conveyed, but jointly produced from the design and the player's interaction with the design. And that is, I think, an interesting way to proceed. That's the questions I have myself. When we have a game for change, how is meaning designed into it? In what kind of player situation does that meaning is being actualized? And would it be interesting, for example, Blast Theory or the Larks or all the pervasive gaming examples that were introduced in the introduction here, that would be interesting to see. Some people claim, well, this is a way to go, and we should more focus on performance art when we want to, and maybe not to persuade people, it's not coercion, but to give them meaningful situation, and maybe not even want to claim that people think in a certain direction, but that they start thinking about something. And sometimes it's better that people even start thinking, and not let that we are not deciding what they are going to think, and that's something what you find here in the work of Bogus. So that's a bit the research we're doing. It's basically focused on health games, but I would love to see the results. I would love to share the results of our research the coming year with this network. Is there a transformative power of gaming? I'm not so sure, but let us understand what we mean by it. I think this is what we do. I'm, like I said, very much inspired by the work of Gilles Deleuze, and he said, what are concepts? Concepts are meaningless, according to Deleuze, unless they are helpful to the understanding and solution of significant contemporary problems. If we have concepts, we can make things visible and action possible. That's a kind of an action-oriented way of the academia. What are we doing? What are we doing, academics? Basically, we are coming up with concepts. And what is the use of concepts? Concepts make things visible. That's the epistemological claim I referred to in the beginning. By using concepts, we can see the reality in a different way. And then together with activists or with other people, we make action possible. And that is something we have to figure out, that we are not only designing individual games, but that we really try to understand what is going on. I'm from a media and culture perspective, and what you see a lot in media studies, for example, Games for Change, that people focus on individual cognition and behavior. And when people talk about the subversive potential of games, I'm also always asking, what do they mean? That people have a change in attitude, a change in cognition. That's of course important, but it's mostly individual. But there's also an importance that there is a kind of a social change. Social change is societal change. Coming together with social movements. And if I understand Scott correctly, this network is not only about academics sitting together with game designers, but also with activists, with artists. So I think we should try to set up these kinds of collaborations. But I think we have to do the both of them. For example, this game, maybe Matthias will know it, it's a German game, Genius im Zentrum der Macht, Genius at the Center of Power, there was a research done. Political game, what was the goal? Political civic education, knowledge game, that people who play the game have more of a political interest, more of an engagement, so that's the kind of games I think we are interested in. And they did a research, does that game really has the effect it claims to have? And what was the result? Well, if people have a high enough education for mid-level kids, then it has certain effects. But when kids have a low-level education, then the game has no effect at all. And why is that the case? It's always a bit difficult to see, but the people who did this research, they said, well, there's a knowledge gap. If you have no clue about politics, you can play a political games, but it doesn't refer to anything. So it had no effect whatsoever. So it's not only about designing the right game, but taking these kinds of things into account. Are we, with our design of the Game for Change, are we having the effect that we think they will have? And I think that's an important question to answer, not an easy one. I was inspired always by the works of Erik Zimmerman here on the left, and Jane McGonigal and the Games of Empire book. This is my favorite game studies book at this very moment in time. And why am I going to present this? Because I think when you focus on these three books, you see different levels of social change. You have different levels of concepts of understanding what is going on. For example, maybe you know all this, Salen and Zimmerman, they make a really interesting distinction between you have a game, you have all kinds of ludic activities, and you have a being playfulness. So in a certain sense, we live in a playful culture. But this is really where specific games are about. And if we want to try to understand what transformative play is, we have to focus on these three different levels. In game, in a ludic activity, in being playful, we can try to set up some transformative, or we can focus on the transformative power of gaming. What is a bit lacking here, I would say, when that's at least my opinion, there's not so much focus on this aspect. Okay, it's logic because they are game designers. They design games. And I think it's really crucial to understand what games are about when we have the claim that we can use games for social change. So it's a really interesting way to approach this problem. And then we have, of course, Jane McGonigal. Gaming can make a better world. Well, when she told that for the first time, I said, this is too good to be true. This cannot be true. And in a certain sense, I have sympathy for it, of course, because gaming can help us setting the first step towards understanding of problems or to lead some cognition or maybe attitude change. But of course, gaming is not good enough to change the world. I think she is so popular because she has a really simple message. It would be great. Let's all start gaming and automatically the world changes. That's basically her message. And I think, well, I can imagine if I would work for Shell or for some big company, I would sponsor her, of course, because we only have to play games. We don't have to change societal structure or something. We only have to play games to make everything working well. So it's a bit too easy of an answer. But of course, also at the same time, I have sympathy for her approach because she shows that on an individual level, people can organize in groups to really start making the first step towards social change, but we should come up with something better, I would say. For example, this book, the one I already referred to, the Games of Empire book, it's really an amazing study, I would say. But a bit of a problem here, and people who are interested in political issues may recognize it, they make a kind of an economic and military and political analysis of Western capitalist society. They refer to certain games, The Sims and America's Army and Grand Theft Auto would be typical for Empire. And then you have the multitude. The multitude is a kind of an overall term where all the people come together, all the protest movements against capitalism. And you have a really interesting overview. I only show here two forms of games that might be of interest, but they give a really nice overview of different approaches to social change. You can also design commercial games and try to put some critical stuff in commercial games. Or you can design tactical games, you can design games for change, for example the Mol Industria game, McDonald's video game, Food for Games or Darfur is Dying games. And it's really interesting. Only sometimes, I don't know if you know the book, but when you read it, we say, well, it's become really complicated now. Before we can do anything, we have to change capitalist society, and I'm only a single human being. How can I ever do that? So what's the use of it all? So because they make the problem so big, and we have to change capitalism before we can do anything. So I would say it's the opposite side of the line. You have, on the one hand, you have people like, and people like De Peuter saying, well, we have to make big changes, otherwise it doesn't matter. And then you have Salem and Zimmerman and McGonagall at the other side of the spectrum. Well, we can start by gaming and making certain games, and then we can start to make a difference. I think we have to decide on which level we are talking. I think we should do everything at the same time. We should have different strategies. That would be my idea. So this is really interesting to see what kind of choices do we make to start making the difference. Let me see, I have, how long do I have, Scott?
You have
30 minutes. Sorry? 30 minutes. 13? 30. Again, 30 minutes? I thought I had only 35 minutes in total or something. Sorry? Okay, that's perfect. So, that would be my idea. How can we bring together those different levels of analysis? We must analyze games. We must see how they work. We must come up with a conceptual framework to better understand what games are about. I will give an example. But we should also have a kind of an analytical framework to understand what society is about. What is social change? How we can understand what is going on. So there are different levels, and of course we cannot do everything at the same time, but we should understand that it's important to understand what's going on those different levels, to be sure that the individual choices we make fit in some certain bigger strategy. Otherwise we could make huge mistakes. I will give a mistake I made myself, so that's always the best example, to criticize yourself. And so I'm now focusing on what people call discourse analysis. Starting point was, I did go to a post-colonial studies conference, and as maybe people are interested in post-colonial studies, but then they would know this book, and The Empire Writes Back. Here, The Empire Writes Back, it was a famous book in post-colonial studies. And I decided to do something on play, so I said, well, if this is a nice title, I change it a bit. And I said, The Empire Plays Back. And I don't know if it works well, the joke in English as well, but I think it is in Dutch. What is playback? What do playback mean? Is it really the power to speak back? Can we make a difference? Or are we playbacking in a sense that it's only a simple mimic, that we repeat what other people already said? That was a bit my question I raised during that postcolonial studies conference. And I think we should, one way or the other, try to figure out the kind of different levels in social change. We should focus on a micro level on the game and the game player, and I think most game studies people are interested in these kind of questions. I, for example, did an analysis, what I call the frame analysis of a game like Darfur is Dying and of Food Force. That's a game studies perspective. And if people are interested in this whole idea, there's a book of Pedro Vorder on serious game where I have an article in about this. I call it the dispositive, but basically it's a bit of discourse analysis. Now, what should we do? I think the coming year, I would love to help develop a framework that's on a micro level understands what games are about. On a meso level, to do a study on discursive practices, for example, conflict studies. So I think as game studies academics, we should start making alliances with people who are specialized in other areas. For example, in conflict studies, we now closely collaborate with conflict studies in Utrecht to understand what these kinds of games are about. And on a macro level, we should also do a kind of a political economy analysis with people from political sciences and economy. And when you already see this, it really starts being complicated. Then I would love to go back to the message of Jane McGonigal. So people, don't worry, only game and everything will be all right. That's way easier as a suggestion than my suggestion here, that we should start bringing people together who do micro, meso, and macro analysis in the field of games for change. But I think this is a necessary thing to do. Otherwise, we start making mistakes, and I will give one example I made myself. For example, Food Force and Darfur is Dying, already a few years ago, but it's just an example to show how it works. I was interested in these kinds of games, and what do? And when you're interested in these kinds of games, this is Darfur is Dying, maybe you know the game. I think it came out of a contest during the Game for Change conference, and they had, I think, $10,000 or $20,000 for a group of students. Susanna Ruiz, she won the competition, and she got money to develop this game. So it's basically a student project. And I was really interested in this game. And I remember what I said when I started. We need a conceptual framework to understand what a game is about, because we can play the games, but then we still have no clue what that specific game is about. And I played the games and I said, well, it's really interesting, but what can I say about it as an academic? So we need concepts to help us out. And I started reading the work of George Lakoff. This is an amazing book. It's a simple book. Only 60 pages or so, not a book like Games of Empire. This is really a must read, I would say, if you would like to understand what frame analysis is about. And what basically Lakoff wants to do in this book, he doesn't talk about games, but he wants to understand why the Republicans always won the elections. And they won a few elections, and he said, well, I'm a Democrat, why are those people always winning? And why are we Democrats always losing? And he, according to him, it has to do with values and of words we use, of concepts we introduce. For example, the war on terror. It was a smart idea of the Republicans. And what did the Democrats do? They always said, we are against the war of terror. That's what the Democratic position always was. But when you deny something, you repeat it in a certain way. That's why the joke of don't think of an elephant is about. For example, I could do a little test with you. So I would ask you the coming 10 seconds and to do something to see if somebody would be able to do so. And my question would be, everybody here, the coming 10 seconds, don't think of an elephant. So please, you still have 5 seconds to go, don't think of an elephant. And then of course, after 10 seconds, I would ask you, is somebody able not thinking of an elephant? And of course the answer is no, because everybody starts thinking of an elephant. But that's quite a strange idea. Until now you didn't think of an elephant, and the moment I asked you not to think of an elephant, you start thinking of an elephant. And that's a bit the way Lakoff tries to understand what the Democrats did wrong. When you say, I'm against the war of terror, and then everybody thinks, oh, war on terror, that's a useful concept. So we should come up with other values, we should come up with other concepts. And he's trying to figure out how it works. Now, I use this, according to Lakoff, he does frame analysis, and there's a strict father and a nurturing parent family model. These are two different values. And you can have the value of helping people, being a nurturing parent, or you can be a strict father. And a strict father is more of a Republican way of approaching reality. And he said, well, it's about values. That's why I was really interested in the Mary Flanagan workshop or lecture, because she refers to values as well. Games are able to help people maybe reframe their value system. And according to Lakoff, reframing is social change. And social change starts with reframing certain values. So I made an analysis of this. I said, well, according to me, games for change such as Darfur is Dying and Food Force, they are really about reframing. They tried, when you play the game, they try to reinforce, so to say, the nurturing parent family model, nurturing parent values. That's the importance of these kinds of games. The United Nations needs to enter Darfur and help those people as a nurturing family model. So I thought I made a really convincing argument. I wrote about this in an article in this book. So if you are interested in it, I can send it to you. And so I said, well, it's a good thing. Those games reinforce the nurturing parent family model, and the United Nations is an important organization to do that. And I presented it during a conference, and there was my colleague from conflict studies, and she was a bit upset. I know I'm exaggerating a bit, but in the end she came to me and said, well, Joost, you are really naive. Your theoretical framework is so disappointing. And I was shocked. I thought I made a nice analysis of what was going on in the Game for Change movement. And what she said, well, Joost, without knowing it, you are reinforcing a certain frame within conflict studies. And that's called the New Wars frame. That's a dominant frame in conflict studies. And it's criticized a lot, because what are you basically claiming? Us versus them. We in the West, we know what's better for those people over there in Darfur. Their wars, they are abused. Our wars, when we go to war, we do it with respect. And the causes are local, and the solutions have to be global. So it's their problem. They turn it into a messy hell over there in Darfur, and we from the West, we have to come in as a nurturing parent to help those people out of their misery. And that's a kind of a new wars frame. That's a dominant frame within conflict studies, and it has been criticized a lot. So it's not about us helping them, but there should be a kind of a change in the system that those people would enable to help themselves. So she said, Joost, your approach is really too limited. You should take into account a second step. You should do a critical discourse analysis of what is basically going on there. And if you support games like Food Force or Darfur is Dying, what you basically do is reinforcing on a bit of a higher level a certain frame. I said, well, that's interesting to know. I was not aware, because I'm not a specialist in conflict studies. And then Jolle and I, we were presenting, we sit together, and he said, well, now we are going to do a better job. And then there came some people, discourses, they construct versions of reality, they do things, they legitimize these things. So it's really important to do discourse analysis. People talk and people write about certain stuff, but it's not neutral, of course, it has certain impact. So Jolle and I, we were sitting together, and he said, now we are going to do a better job, we are going to do this. Where was it? I did a microanalysis, Jolle did a mesoanalysis, and we presented it at a conference, and then somebody came over. Of course, you already recognize it. People from a political economy analysis, they said, well, it's interesting what you say, but did you take into account that maybe you are reinforcing a neoliberal frame? I said, oh my God, it's becoming more and more complicated. I said, well, that's interesting. That's why I'm interested in the whole empire discussion. So that is really tricky. And now it's becoming more and more tricky. So I was really pleased, so to say, with the Games for Change movement. Darfur is dying in food for us. But I, of course, we should continue with doing these things. But I think it's at the same time very important to try to understand what it is that we're doing. On what level want to make a difference, and is it a good thing or not? And are we not unconsciously reinforcing certain things that we don't want to reinforce? And that turns it into a quite complicated business. And basically, what we try to do is that's a good thing that we became a focus area at Utrecht University. That we sit together with people who do political economy. We do economy, we do conflict studies, and sit together with game studies people to try to figure out what is really going on. And I think that's important. I would not claim that we should stop doing anything before we understand what is actually going on. I think we can have really different levels of making the difference. When we have already one person who changes his opinion about something can be the starting point of something new. So I'm not claiming that it's important to start changing the economic structures of Western capitalism as it is. Some people do. I'm now reading a PhD thesis of a student of the University of Leiden. They do Japanese studies in the Netherlands. And he said, well, it's in Western capitalist system, it's really impossible to imagine even something else. It's impossible to imagine an alternative. If I would ask you, what's the alternative for capitalism, if we criticize it? Then it would maybe be silent. What could be the alternative for capitalism? And this guy is claiming that he wrote that thesis. I'm only in chapter one right now. He said, well, in Japanese science fiction games, there is a kind of an other opinion of what politics is about, and there you can find an answer to your question, what is the alternative? So I'm really... I will try to read it today or tomorrow, that if you stay until Friday, I can give you some answers on Friday. So it's a multi-layered system. I think it's good to realize that. Okay, my questions, maybe discussion points, and I'm closing. This is my last slide, but I still have two slides to go. When we talk about persuasion, we don't focus on coercion. I was a bit surprised, but in the book I refer to the Serious Games book of Peter Vorderen. There's an article of Klimt in it, and it was, I would say, mind-blowing. What is he saying? You are designing a game for change, and people might have resistance towards your message. And what should we do as a game designer? And he claims, well, we should try to understand in what way people could possibly have resistance towards the message, and then we must undo the resistance. And I said, well, this is a kind of a manipulation, and that would be something I would not be very interested in. It's not about coercion, I would say, against for a change. Maybe that's a notion somebody referred to me a few weeks ago. You have guided play. Maybe people who are in pedagogy know that term. It's kind of an experiential learning opportunity, and player participation is really important. So it's not about persuading people to do something that they would not be willing to do anyway. So it's always a bit difficult. I don't want to persuade people to something they are not interested in. I want that people develop their own opinion about something. So maybe it's already something that people start thinking, and not so much that they start thinking in a specific direction. So this is really a question we ask ourselves. I'm not interested in persuasion when we mean with persuasion that we reduce the resistance of people, but I want to start a conversation with people. And I would love to hear some opinions of also game designers how you could do it. This is something I think is really important, that we as academics sit together with game designers, artists, activists. I remember when I was at the Games for Change conference a couple of years ago, and some people was a guy standing up. He said, well, social movements always used media, of course, and now maybe they can use games to help them. But then still, games are part of a broader media ecological system. It's not only about designing a game and hoping for the best. I think it's important to make these kinds of alliances, to set up something. Otherwise, you only have a game with a really individual effect, and maybe that's not too interesting. Last slide. Because I saw Scott also referring in one of the things you sent me that people were also interested in journalism and journalism studies. I don't know if anybody here is interested in journalism, but a PhD student of mine, he's a bit interested in the same questions, but then from a journalist perspective. In journalism studies, and I'm not a specialist in journalism studies, so if anybody is, so please help me out. You have a kind of a social empathy journalism. So journalism is not only about informing and forming the public, not only about informing but also forming the public, it's about engagement, engaged journalism. On the other side of the spectrum, you have objective reporting. When you are a journalist, you should objectively report what is going on. And people who do social empathy journalism is just a bunch of bullshit. Some people claim it's just about persuading people to think about a certain subject. And of course, there are a lot of people who want to find a third way into this. So could you claim that what you do is objective reporting, but from a social empathy perspective? And that's a kind of a third way in journalism studies. And the friend of mine, he's the media director of the KRO. It's one of the big public broadcasters in the Netherlands. And he wrote a really beautiful thesis where he is claiming that there's a third way. You can refer to objective facts, but from an engaged perspective, that you ask people to start thinking about a certain subject. And critical realism is a kind of a philosophical underpinning of this kind of a third way. And I think it is really interesting also for Games for Change people. Could we not only try to persuade people in thinking about something in a certain direction, but could we refer to objective facts still from a social empathy perspective? So I think we could learn something. I don't know much more about this than I'm telling you now, because I just learned about via the PhD thesis a student of mine is writing. But I think this could be interesting for Game for Change people to make alliances with people who do journalism studies. So there's, I think, a bunch of questions for us all to answer, not only today and the coming days here, but also for the coming year. I don't know, is it for a year the network? One year or 2 years?
Yeah.
Yeah. Maybe you can do some nice alliances with the network of Patrick Rogan, the Creative Territories. Maybe we could even set up a workshop during the summer school with your group of people in Utrecht last 2 weeks of August. So I think there are plenty of possibilities of collaboration. So I'm really looking forward to it. And thanks for your attention. And now I gave you all the questions, so I hope you have some answers for me. Okay, thank you very much for listening.